Dear students, welcome back. In this session, we will learn about gastrulation in frog. So we are already familiar with the process of gastrulation, whose main target is to form the three germ layers and to displace this cavity of blastula, the blastocele, by a new cavity called the archenteron. So in this session, we will discuss in detail the formation of gastrula in frog. I am Dr. Lata, Assistant Professor, Department of Zoology, Maharani Science College, Bhavi, Men, Bengaluru. Now we know that this gastrulation, the process of gastrulation involves various morphogenetic movements and rearrangement of cells, and this process of gastrulation in amphibians appears quite complex when compared to that of amphioxus. So the main task of this gastrulation is to bring the surface, bring cells from the surface of the blastula to the inside for forming endodermal organs, and to surround the embryo with cells capable of forming ectoderm, and to place the mesoderm in between this ectoderm and endoderm, so that each of these germ layers will give rise to their respective derivatives as and when the embryo differentiates. Now the main morphogenetic movements involved are mainly the invagination, followed by it initiates the gastrulation process, which is followed by a variety of cell movements, which includes convergence, divergence, involution and epiboly. All these morphogenetic movements are seen in this process of gastrulation, and predominantly the initiation takes place by the process of invagination. So let us understand the process of gastrulation in frog. So gastrulation in frog is initiated on the future dorsal side, just below the equator, in the marginal zone, that is the area of Gray Crescent, where the animal and the vegetal hemispheres meet. It is that point where the process of invagination takes place. So here the endodermal cells are not so large and yolky at this region, where in the region of Gray Crescent. So the small endodermal cells in this region invaginate, that means they try to sink in to form a slit like groove. The formation of the groove is the first external sign of gastrulation. Now the invaginating cells, when we say a particular cell is invaginating, that means there has to be some change in its shape so that it can invaginate in. So these invaginating cells, they exhibit a drastic change in their shape. They constrict at their apical surface and expand at their bases, but they remain attached to the outside surface by a slender neck, and these cells are called bottle cells because of the shape that they are formed. Now the change in shape of these cells into bottle shaped cells is associated with the inward pulling movement, which results in the formation of a small groove. Now this diagram explains you the whole thing very clearly. We said at the point of invagination, that is in the Gray Crescent region, towards the upper portion of these endodermal cells, few cells become, they start moving inside, and here you can see the formation of the structure of these blastomeres. If you observe the here, if you see the structure of blastomere which is invaginating, you can make out that the blastomeres of this region, they have all changed their shape. See, from the round kind of endodermal cells, here when they are invaginating, they have become like this bottle shaped cells, right? And this in turn, like, you know, it pushes the cells which are and these are invaginating, they are moving inside. So as a result, what happens? They exert a kind of pressure on the neighboring cells, and again they'll start moving in. Now when we say these cells, the invaginating cells or the invaginating macromeres, the invagination of this macromeres, which occurs in this marginal zone just below the gray crescent, that results in the formation of a blastopore. This is the blastopore that we are talking about. As the cells are moving inside, you know, here, as the from this region of gray crescent, the cells are moving inside, they are invaginating. Because of that, it gives rise to the formation of an opening, the blastopore. Now this invagination occurs on account of change in the shape and movement of these macromeres in the marginal zone. Now these cells undergoing invagination become bottle shaped. Their outer ends, which are firmly attached to the outer surface, becomes attenuated and they become bottle shaped. They form a long neck. See here, if you see in this diagram, one end of them are attached to this outer surface, and their this outer end of these cells are drawn into long neck, a slender neck like thing. So keeping in contact with this outer surface firmly, they tend to invaginate inside, whereas the distal free end expands. This change in shape is presumed to be a form of amoeboid movement, and this is an intrinsic phenomenon and is performed by the cells themselves. There is no external stimulus given to that, and it occurs on its own. The cells have this inherent ability to invaginate, and this region on this gray crescent is what is called as the organizers, because by the movement of these cells, that in turn organizes the whole gastrula, wherein it forms the three germ layers, and it is because of this initiation that all the three germ layers are formed in their respective positions. So because of this, this particular region of this dorsal lip of blastopore is called as the region of organizer. And a scientist by name Spiemann and Mangold, they have worked a lot on, they have conducted many experiments to understand this concept of organizer and how it helps, or how it, you know, in turn triggers this movement of the cells into ectoderm, endoderm and the mesoderm. All that we will learn little later in our later sessions. So for the time being, you just know that this dorsal lip of blastopore is called as the region of organizer, because the cells from this region are the first ones to invaginate. And who tells them to invaginate? They do on their own, because they possess that inherent ability in them. And just because they start invaginating, the rest all processes follow. And hence the process of gastrulation continues. So this is the first step in this process of gastrulation, the formation of bottle cells, which in turn continues with the process of invagination. Now this picture will give you much more clear idea as to how this process of the change in shape of these cells. You can observe here the endodermal cells have changed into bottle shaped cells, and even when there is a change in shape, these bottle shaped cells are keeping in contact with the groove, and as the cells are pulled inwards, that results in the formation of this groove, which later becomes the archenteron. And as more and more cells invaginate, the blastocoel becomes reduced in its size, and that blastocoel will be replaced by the archenteron. Now this diagram also explains this formation of bottle cells. And once the bottle cells are formed, during early gastrulation, what happens? The cells that are there in this deep marginal zone, that is the cells below these bottle cells, they show interdigitation to form the band of mesodermal cells and move in by involution. Now the endodermal cells invaginate, whereas the mesodermal cells, they involute. And we know the difference between involution and invagination. Now, as these blastomeres move in, they drive this movement of surface endodermal cells with the bottle cells leading and the archenteron lengthening. As a result, what happened? The cavity of the archenteron increases, which thereby recedes the blastocyst formation. So here what you need to observe is the interdigitation of the cells below the bottle cells, and they in turn become these they are the mesodermal cells, which in turn involute inside. Now once the initial groove is formed, this initial groove probably is formed due to a coordinated contraction of apical ends of this bottle cells in a plane perpendicular to their long axis, as occurs in the invaginating epithelia in general. So the opening of this groove is called blastopore. Now before these bottle cells are formed, there is an internal cell arrangement that pushes the cells of this dorsal floor of the blastocysts made up of vegetal cells towards the animal pole. Now this rotation of these vegetal cells places the pharyngeal endodermal cells, which are adjacent to the blastocoel, immediately above the mesodermal cells that begin to move inside. So the pharyngeal endoderm cells that start migrating along the roof of the blastocoel towards the future anterior end of the embryo. Now this initial shallow groove formed in this dorsal lip, which is the beginning of the groove or the cavity known as archenteron. Now as the bottle cells which invaginate to form the groove leave this dorsal lip, their place is taken by the new group of cells derived from the more anterior regions of the marginal zone, that is the gray crescent. Now what do? They roll over this dorsal lip, that's why this moment is called involution, and they continue to migrate inward, so thereby they deepen the groove, which groove? The groove of archenteron. Now these endodermal cells that migrate from the superficial marginal zone form the roof of the deepening groove, which becomes the tubular archenteron. Now this lining of cells is the future gut lining. Archenteron is the future gut, and this lining becomes the lining of this future gut. Now this continued inward migration of the involuted cells extends the archenteron into the blastocoel anteriorly until its tip reaches to the inner surface of this animal pole region. As the archenteron expands, the blastocoel cavity gets reduced and ultimately obliterated. Now the next step involves the involution of pharyngeal endoderm and cardamysoderm. These large yolky cells of this vegetal zone, which also they also exhibit slow inward streaming movements, so that the cells initially which are situated in the vegetal pole just below the initial groove reach the anterior part of the archenteron floor, and those from the vegetal pole region come to be located at the posterior part. Thus the first cells to undergo involution over the dorsal lip of the blastopore are the pharyngeal endodermal cells. So the first one to involute at the dorsal lip of blastopore or this pharyngeal endodermal cells. Whereas the presumptive mesodermal cells, they lie in the deep marginal zone, while a thin layer of endodermal cells lie on its superficial marginal zone. Now, during gastrulation, several layers of these deep involuting marginal zone cells, they interdigitate, as we have seen in the previous picture, by a process known as radial intercalation to form a thin, broad, single layer. Further, this intercalation takes place as the cells involute into the embryo. Now, this intercalation causes a convergent extension, thereby integrating several mesodermal streams to form a single long narrow band. The anterior part of this band migrates towards the animal pole, followed by continued migration of the mesodermal streams. Now, this radial and mediolateral intercalations of these deep cells appear to be responsible for the continued movement of mesoderm into the embryo. Now, the involution of cells into the embryo follows a precise sequence. As explained earlier, the pharyngeal endoderm cells are the first to involute over the dorsal lip, of the blastopore. As the cells move to the interior, they are followed by precaudal plate cells, which form the precursor of the head mesoderm, and the next cells to involute into the embryo through this dorsal lip of blastopore are the carda mesodermal cells, which form the precursor of the notochord. Meanwhile, the blastopore lip also extends laterally, forming the blastopore crescent with lateral lips. Now, here are the diagram to summarize whatever we have learned so far. So, at the beginning of the gastrulation, the involuting marginal zone forms, and this pink color, which is not exactly pink, it represents, this region represents the prospective head mesoderm region, and the carda mesoderm is represented in this region. And then the endoderm is represented in yellow, and the pharyngeal endoderm, it moves forward, driving the mesoderm passively into the embryo and towards the animal pole. And the ectoderm begins to it stretches itself to cover the whole embryo through the process of epiboly. Now, later what happens? The precaudal plate, it becomes a part of the roof of the archenteron, and the anterior part of the notochord extends along the dorsal side of the archenteron and occupies its mid-dorsal region on the archenteron roof. Meanwhile, the presumptive posterior notochordal cells involute over these dorsolateral lips of blastopore, and later they join this anterior notochordal cells. Thus, those mesodermal cells that enter over this dorsal lip form the central dorsal mesoderm, which in turn gave rise to notochord and the somites. And majority of the mesoderm, consisting of presumptive somatic mesoderm and the ventrolateral mesoderm, they involute by rolling over the lateral and ventral lips of blastopore. Now, when all these are happening, the third morphogenetic movement that we see is a convergence. Now, at the same time, the ectodermal cells of the animal hemisphere begin to cover the embryo by epiboly to converge at the extended blastopore. As epiboly continues, a ventral lip of blastopore forms, and soon it becomes a complete circle. The invagination of cells is much more extensive around the dorsal lip of the blastopore than at the lateral and the ventral lips. The yolky endodermal cells of vegetal hemisphere encircled by a blastopore forms the yolk plug. By the end of gastrulation, the blastopore is reduced to a narrow vertical slit. This phenomenon of transference of particular cell type from the surface of the embryo and their accumulation in the specific region is what is known as convergence, as described by Vogt. Now, once this involution of the mesoderm is over, these cells move from the posterior side towards the anterior side as a single layer called as carda mesodermal mantle. It occupies a space between the ectoderm and the endoderm, except for a small part of the anterior end of the gastrula. This part does not contain mesoderm and later forms the mouth. The point where the endoderm and the ectoderm meet at the blastopore, that point becomes the anus. Now, the next stage in the process of gastrulation of frog is the formation and closure of this blastopore. Now, this blastopore, this diagram explains the process of initiation of the blastopore till its closure, and the diagram towards your right hand side shows you the cross section through this cross section of the embryo at the yolk plug stage. Now, this blastopore appears in the beginning of gastrulation when invagination of macromere starts at the lower margin of Gray crescent, and its dorsal lip is formed by the involution of micromeres of the Gray crescent. Gradually, the invagination increases and spreads laterally so that the crescent-shaped blastopore first appears as a half moon, as you can see in the diagram. Then, so when we look at this structure of blastopore, as we said, first it appears as half moon and then it becomes horseshoe shaped and finally as a full circle, as depicted in these diagrams. Its lateral lips are formed by the continued invagination of micromeres of this marginal zone on the lateral sides also. These extend all along the boundary between the marginal zone and the vegetal region, and ultimately they meet midventrally, thereby completing the ventral lip of blastopore. Thus, the blastopore is completed and it encircles the vegetal region, and the cells of this vegetal hemisphere visible through the completed blastopore are known as yolk plug, and the embryo at this stage is called as yolk plug stage. So you can see the diagram towards your right hand side here, which shows the representation of this yolk plug stage. So when the lips of this blastopore are being formed, the rim of the blastopore, it gradually shifts over the macromeres of this vegetal pole. As a result, the combined action of epiboly and convergence, the blastopore, which is a wide aperture in the initial stages, that gradually narrows down until the end of gastrulation, the blastopore is recognizable as just a slit, narrow slit, and the protruding yolk plug is drawn into the archenteron. Now, the next kind of morphogenetic movement that is seen is the epiboly of ectoderm. Here, from the time the first appearance of the blastopore slit on the dorsal side, the presumptive ectoderm, including the epidermal and neural, expands to cover the whole embryo by a process known as epiboly. So, as this as the gastrulation proceeds, the cells of this animal pole and non-involuting marginal cells, they expand by epiboly to cover the entire embryo. So this process helps in the formation of circular blastopore and in the enclosing of all the yolky endodermal cells inside the embryo. So now this epiboly is an active process wherein it completely encompasses the mesodermal and the endodermal cells inside the embryo and covers the whole surface of the embryo. So this diagram represents how epiboly occurs, and it has taken in all the mesodermal and the endodermal blastomeres, thereby resulting in closing of the blastopore lip. Now, when you look at this, what is the significance of this gastrulation, or when does this rotation of gastrula occurs? See, as we have seen in this previous picture, what is happening? The epiboly is surrounding the whole embryo and it has taken in all the yolk-laden endodermal cells inside, and the mesodermal cells from the marginal zone or the gray crescent has also moved inside to occupy the layer between ectoderm and the endoderm. Now, when all these endodermal macromeres have moved inside, that results in and when these blastomeres move inside, it suppresses this blastocele, and then it results in enlargement of archenteron. So when such difference occurs, there is a change in the gravitational axis of the embryonic mass, because of which the blastopore gets shifted by 90 degrees. Now when such shift occurs, the blastopore will come back to its original vegetal pole region, which in turn forms the future, which in turn forms the anus of this future organism that is developing from this embryo. So this is one of the most significant step, which in turn brings back blastopore to its original position because of this rotational change. Now when we look at the structure of a fully formed gastrula, here what happens, the monoblastic blastula gets converted into a triploblastic gastrula having three germ layers, the ectoderm, which is present on the outer side, which covers the gastrula externally, then mesoderm, which forms the middle layer, which sits in between ectoderm and the endoderm, and the endoderm, which forms the innermost layer and very much in contact with the archenteron. And it is these three germ layers, they occupy their destined position so that it can give rise to the structures of the larva or the adult. And this endoderm forming, the ectoderm forming this mid-dorsal band is the presumptive nervous system, and the rest of the ectoderm forms epidermis. The gastrocele, or the cavity of the gastrula, that is archenteron, is the primitive gut. The roof of the archenteron is covered by the carda mesodermal mantle. We know what carda mesoderm stands for. It is the notochord forming blastomeres plus the mesoderm forming blastomeres. Together we called it as carda mesodermal mantle, and the floor and the sides by the endodermal cells. Now, this gastrula then undergoes a next process called as neurulation, wherein the formation of neural tube takes place, and this occurs with the help of another process called as neurulation. These are the reference books from which this content has been taken, and here are the few questions for you. Gastrulation in frog involves all these morphogenetic movements. So the right answer is answer D. During gastrulation in frog, the blastocele, what is the fate of the blastocele? Whether it becomes gut, or is it filled with mesoderm and disappears, or is it displaced by archenteron, which is a precursor of the gut, or it doesn't change but develops into archenteron? The right answer is option C. The beginning of the formation of archenteron in the development of frog represents in which stage? Does it seen in the blastula stage, early gastrula, late gastrula, or neurula stage? It happens at the early gastrula stage. So the right answer is option B. the first cells to undergo involution over the dorsal lip of the blastopore are the pharyngeal endodermal cells, precordal cells, notochordal cells, or the ectodermal cells. The answer is option A, the pharyngeal endodermal cells. Blastopore is found in, whether it is found in gastrula or blastula, at the first instance it is found in gastrula, and then cavity of gastrula is archenteron. So blastopore is the opening of the archenteron. So the right option is it is found in gastrula and is the opening of archenteron. So the right option is option B. So with this, I hope you have understood this concept of gastrulation in frog. So for any queries, you can write to me at my mail ID vlatadamodaran@gmail.com. I hope you enjoyed this session. Thank you for listening.